dose image quality, how to improve imaging techniques in the radiation therapy realm. So that's where most of my research has been focused. But, you know, you kind of go along, you kind of find your niche, I guess, as a clinical physicist. It is a big department here. So in a large department, you know, everyone has their own kind of specialties, their own things that they're better at. But then you kind of unexpectedly can hit kind of a fork in the road. So I got this email on a Friday afternoon from my boss, and no one wants to receive, and that's all it said. Are you going to be in Monday? We need to talk. And no one wants to get that from their boss at the end of a day going into a weekend, because I spent the next 2 days wondering what I had done and how much trouble I was going to be in. And I'm not a person who stresses very much, so I didn't really stress over it, but I truly was wondering what on earth had happened that I got that email right before a weekend. And then I still remember this. On the Sunday night, it suddenly crossed my mind, what if he's going to ask me to be the radiation safety officer? And then I was petrified and really hoping I'd done something wrong and was just going to get in trouble. Because our radiation safety officer, who is one of the senior physicists here, some of you would know him, it was Dave Wilkins before me. He had just sort of announced that he was going to be retiring shortly, and it was fairly soon. And it had not been publicly stated who was going to take over as the radiation safety officer. So, you know, for the graduate students, you have to have a radiation safety officer for the licensing within the cancer center. So that role had to be filled. And I was petrified that that might be what my boss was going to ask me about the next morning, because with no offense to any RSOs on the call, they're really, no one that I've ever spoken to actually intended or wanted or asked to be a radiation safety officer, including myself. And everyone, my predecessor, Dave, said that the best RSO is a reluctant RSO. So he said, you'll be fine. So yes, that is what my boss was asking me about. I walked into his office and it was him and Dave sitting there, and it was a complete ambush. And they know I don't say no easily. So here I was. So then I became the RSO. And that's how I unexpectedly kind of took on that role, which, you know, has a learning curve. The physics of it is not difficult, but definitely the administration of it is challenging at times. What does it entail? I had no idea actually before, because I think most of us would rather not know, and would, you know that the RSO does paperwork and does training, but you'd really rather not know everything else that they do. I had a ton of respect for Dave before he retired. I have a whole lot more now that I've tried to step into his shoes, but it is a largely administrative role. There's a lot of paperwork, a lot of record keeping. It involves all the license applications, inspections, training, teaching, answering the random questions that come up, and it involves being on every committee they can possibly put you on, whether at the hospital, provincially. In Quebec, there's a similar thing. There's sort of a radiation safety kind of provincial committee. There's national committees. And actually that has made it really interesting. Participation of those committees has been really interesting for me. So how do you learn? It's sort of a trial by fire, I guess. We do have a corporate radiation safety office at the Ottawa Hospital, who used to provide a 0.5 FTE, like full-time equivalent, support for the RSO role in the cancer center. That person left the hospital 2 months after Dave left. She was supposed to be my security blanket, and then she also left. So it was really just trial by fire. So in 3.5 years, it was just learning on the job. I had 2 weeks of overlap with Dave after I found out I was taking over and that he was leaving. So I did not get the chance to learn sort of from him directly, although he is easily bought with a beer. So he has continued to answer my emails over the last few years. It's a busy center. We've gone through a huge equipment replacement. These numbers probably don't mean much to anyone unless you've been through all the licensing processes, but it has been a very busy 3 years, including a CNSC inspection, which happened fairly shortly after I took over. We were due for one. The big type one inspection where they come for a week and interview a million people and look at all your records. It went very well, but that actually was a great opportunity for me to make sure I had all my ducks in a row and I had learned everything there was to learn about the program. We've also been doing some construction activities, which for me has been interesting because I'd never previously been involved with, you know, project planning at the hospital, architects, designing bunkers, that sort of thing. So those aspects of it are actually quite interesting, but you kind of sort of learn. The license applications become routine when you do them, you know, two a year, you end up, they become kind of just paperwork that you file. So you kind of fall into some kind of routine with that as well. And then along came the gamma pod. So it is rare in radiation safety or in medical physics for that matter to have an opportunity, and I'll call it an opportunity to be involved in the installation and licensing and clinical implementation of a completely novel device. So what is the gamma pod? It is a device that is specifically designed for partial breast irradiation. It's developed by a US company. There are only two of them currently in operation treating patients. There are 3.5 or 4 installed. So ours was the third one installed. There was also one in Pittsburgh that was in the process of being installed last winter. I don't know where that landed with COVID once things got halted. So it is an investigational device. It is only approved in Canada for investigational, like clinical trials. It uses cobalt. You can sort of think of a gamma knife, which is a hemispherical arrangement of cobalt sources, a lot more of them, to treat brain lesions. Think of the gamma knife turned on its side, so it's for treating breast instead. So this shows, I don't know where my nose is, probably over here. There's essentially a patient table. The patient stands on it, is lifted up, it lowers down, and these tungsten shielding doors open up, and then the breast is lowered down into this hemisphere of cobalt sources. It uses a sort of plastic breast cup, which for mobilization, so there's gentle suction, a gentle vacuum applied. So the patient is CT'd this way, the suction stays on, the planning is done, the patient goes for treatment right away, nothing moves is the theory between CT and the treatment. There has to be one of these tabletops in the CT room as well for that. So that's the system. It's quite an interesting system. Details are certainly well thought out for it. From a practical standpoint for us, a lot of the construction, licensing, the shielding calculations, the, you know, how do we shield for this thing, were done before my time. This was a long process, a long road to get there. So there are 25 sources. It changed from the time we did after the construction. It used to be 36 sources, now it's 25, but higher activity. So we had to go back and make sure our shielding was still adequate. Gives a total activity there, but essentially you can see here, there's sort of the primary beam is in an arc above the horizontal, wherever those cobalt sources can point directly at the walls. So it posed a few challenges as far as designing the room, but as I said, that was largely done before I became involved in it. To give you an idea of what I mean by a long story, this started way back in 2013, long before I was aware of it. And essentially it has to start with the research proposals and clinical trial protocols, because if you don't have patients to treat on the device, then there's no point getting the device. It needs a lot of approvals from regulatory agencies to the hospital, to everyone, because obviously a lot of funding is involved in this, donor money. And then you need a licensing from the Nuclear Safety Commission, license to construct. So it was installed very shortly after I took over as the radiation safety officer. And I'm going to throw in this little arrow here, and I'm going to suggest that I now have an idea of why Dave chose to retire when he did. So it was installed shortly, early in 2017, mechanically installed. So for a couple of years, it wasn't meant to be a couple of years, but it got delayed. But for a couple of years, it was installed, the software was installed, everything was working, there were no sources in it, but we could basically go through and do a lot of dry runs and testing of the whole process, from imaging to treatment, if you want to say, although we didn't have sources to treat with. And then there was a big flurry of activity, you know, in late 2018 to try to prepare for source loading, which kept getting pushed back. So it ended up being in late 2019 that we did the source loading. But what I want to talk a little bit about here is sort of this idea of the preparing for something that hadn't been done before is a challenge, because, I mean, I personally had not worked with cobalt. The Ottawa Hospital got rid of their last cobalt machine in 2010. I was here then, but I didn't have a lot of work with it. I didn't do much with it, so I can't say I had any experience with cobalt. And also, this was only the third time they were installing sources in a unit. It was the first time doing it in Canada, which posed different problems because the transport containers are different here. The ones that are approved are different here from in the US, so they had to redesign some of their source loading equipment to deal with the Canadian transport containers. So there were some uncertainties, let's say, because it was largely an untested process. So this failure modes and effects analysis, I'll come back to a little bit, but I just want to give an idea of, well, A, what that means and why we would use something like that in radiation safety. So failure modes and effects analysis, if for those not familiar with it, is basically dreaming up all the ways something can go wrong. And, you know, then you have to think of all these different ways, failure modes, all these ways it can go wrong. How likely is that to happen? How bad would it be if that happens? And how likely are we to notice that it happened? So, you know, you think of a virtual meeting, you know, failure mode is me getting my internet cut off and I get, well, everyone in Ontario and Quebec is using virtual learning right now and the internet dies. You know, I get cut off from the meeting. Well, everyone's going to detect it, so that's easy. How likely is it? More likely now than it was 2 weeks ago, I suspect. And, you know, what's the severity? Not much. Everyone gets a little extra long lunch hour. So that's kind of the idea of the FMEA analysis. It is frequently used. You can do a literature search. You can find lots of examples of FMEA style, you know, investigations in related to clinical processes, new treatments, new devices. But if you look specifically for radiation safety uses of it, it's a lot harder to find. But, you know, why not use it for radiation safety events? Radiation safety is not generally viewed as a particularly exciting area, but the impacts are potentially high. So, you know, if something goes wrong with our source loading, it could impact staff and public safety. It could impact clinical operations, could impact security. So there are potentially serious consequences if something were to go wrong. And, you know, few people at a center often give a great deal of thought to radiation safety. The RSO has to. And I don't mean to imply that people work unsafely. I just mean when you're doing your daily safety checks, when you're doing, you know, you wear your TLD, you're not giving a whole ton of thought to that. It's just part of your job and that's what you do. So there, you know, it's not often that you kind of take a step back and really give some thought to radiation safety issues. So is it true that people don't think about it? No, but sometimes you don't. So I'm gonna step away from the gamma pod for a second and give just an example. So the last person out button in the LINAC bunkers is regulated. The CNSC requires that there is some kind of device that has to be activated from inside the room before the beam can be turned on. And the idea being that the person leaving the room to turn on the beam looks around the room and says, I am the last person in here, so I can go out, turn on the beam, and no one's in the room. That's the whole idea of it. These are tested daily. They're part of the safety checks. All staff are aware of them. They know how to use them properly. They know what they're for. But for someone who goes in and out of the room 40 times a day, or a physicist who's in and out of the room every 5 minutes when they're working on the weekend by themselves, it kind of becomes a little routine, or it can become a little routine. If I'm the only one there on a Saturday and I've been working for 8 hours and been in and out of the room a bunch of times in that time, am I really surveying the entire room every time I press that button? Or am I pressing it as I need to press it so I can turn on the beam? And that's a human nature, and it's not a, you know, an intentional thing, but that's just human nature. So this is the sort of thing where a failure modes and effects analysis can be useful. Because, and I'm not suggesting we do it on the LPO buttons, but to sort of justify where, why it might be useful. It's a way to determine what might go wrong and what are the consequences if it does. And then it lets you look at, you know, well, how would we stop this from happening? Or if it happens, how do we make sure it's not a big deal? So in the example of the last person out button, prevention might include redundancy. So yes, there's a last person out button. As I leave the room, I'm supposed to look around the room and say no one else is in it. But let's say I don't do that and I press the button and I walk out. Well, also regulated and required is that you have an in-room camera. So I walk out having not looked around the room, and I get out and I see on the in-room camera that someone's in there walking around. Well, that's the redundancy that will, you know, back me up if I don't do what I'm supposed to do as I leave the room. So that's one way to sort of mitigate this happening. But if I walk out of the room and I don't check the room first, and then I get out and the person who's in the room is standing off in a corner and isn't caught on the camera, okay, then my redundancy fails, so I press the beam on button, and now I've beamed on and someone is in the room. So how do we limit the potential for this becoming a serious incident? One thing is that they're in-room beam on lights. So those aren't meant for the patient. They're meant for someone who's in the room. It's to alert them. So if somehow you're left in the room and the beam comes on, well, you know, hopefully that will catch your eye and you'll see that the beam has come on. Or you hear the machine kick in, there are emergency stop buttons. I can hit them and I can leave the room quickly. This is just an example of systems that are in place. These have been in place for years. But, you know, when I ask around at the hospital, I've heard of at least 3 different incidents in Ottawa where a staff member has been in the room while someone has beamed on. But these were years and years ago, long before my time, and before any of these systems were in place. Since these systems have been in place, I have not heard of a single incident of someone being left in the room. So success, or is it overkill? Do we, you know, the therapists have to do this every morning, it takes time away from patient treatments, but we can say that, you know, it works in the sense that you have redundancy built in, and then you have, if somehow all the different, you know, in the Swiss cheese model, all the holes line up and someone's still left in the room, then you have a way that this doesn't become a serious incident. So that's kind of an example of where, you know, if you could dream up all the failure modes and then come up with ways to make sure they don't cause a huge problem, that's where an FMEA analysis could happen. And so I was a little, maybe not entirely truthful when I said I haven't heard of this happening ever since these systems came into place. So 2020 is a year that I think for a lot of people brought a lot of surprises and things that, you know, they didn't see coming. And one of them for us was that we actually had an incident where the beam was turned on with someone in the room. It was a staff member. And so it's the first time it's ever happened that anyone can remember, certainly in physics. So it goes back a long time. And it was a case of, you know, commissioning work, 2 people working in and out of the room a million times in the day. And you don't notice that the other person is ducked in to get something while you were in there, turns on the beam. So the redundant safety checks to prevent it from happening didn't work, but the sort of risk mitigation devices did, because the person who was left in the room, what caught their eye was the in-room beam on light. They saw that come on. They said after the adrenaline rush, they realized they should get out of there. So they hit the emergency stop button, left the room. We did a dose estimate. We estimated it to be unmeasurable. We sent the TLD in for reading. It was below the detectable limit. There was no dose. There was no measurable dose to the person. There was no actual consequence from a health perspective. The person who had turned on the beam was far more upset by the whole, as you might imagine, by the whole incident than anyone else, because they were disappointed that it had happened, that they had done it. But by and large, the sort of the safety systems worked the way they were intended. And the error was in not using it the way they were intended. So I'll jump back to the gammapod and I'll highlight these sort of things in red, this source loading, what our attempts to dream up all the nightmare scenarios ahead of the source loading. And I've added a small line here afterwards, which wasn't on my first timeline of the source return. So you can see how it went. That gives a preview of how it went, I guess. So the source loading process, by and large, can I broke it down into four areas or four parts. So the trucks arrive, or the sources arrive on the truck. It's a 7-ton shipping container from Nordion. Nordion was the one making the sources. That arrives. That can't easily be transported through the hospital, although it can, but you have to make some provisions for that. You don't want to cave in any floors or damage any floors in doing so. Normally, the way this had been done in the two previous installations is they would take the shipping container into the bunker, and then they have a transfer cask that they have to lift the sources out of this shipping container into the transfer cask, and the transfer cask is what sort of marries up against the treatment unit, and the sources get put it loaded that way. That transfer cask is what had to be redesigned for the Canadian shipping container, so it had never been used before. This picture is actually taken in their factory in Maryland. One year prior to our source loading, they had borrowed the shipping container and they had it for a week at their facility so that they could do a mock source loading to see if everything worked, if all the components lined up, if everything worked. So two of us from Ottawa, as well as someone from the CNSC, went down and watched this to see what it would look like. So I've shown this picture here. That's not obviously where we did the transfer, but the sources were taken off the truck. They're moved to the location of the hospital where we're going to do this transfer into the more mobile cask. The transfer cask weighs 2 tons, so it's lighter, but still needs to be carefully moved around the hospital. But this, I don't know how well you can see it, it's a small picture, but there's an A-frame here where the hoist is, and that needs a certain amount of clearance. And unfortunately, the bunker where the unit is installed is an old bunker, and it was 1/2 foot short in ceiling clearance. So we couldn't do this in the bunker itself, which was really unfortunate because the bunker is shielded for radiation and all the security systems were in place. So if anything went wrong, you could close the doors, lock the doors, and everyone is safe. So we had to do it in a public area. We debated hallways. We debated the atrium of the cancer center. We debated the outside the main entrance of the hospital. We went through all sorts of locations that had enough clearance, which from a security perspective adds problems, and from a radiation safety perspective adds problems because, you know, if a source broke or if there was leakage or something happened, you're in a very public area and it suddenly impacts far more than just that one bunker. So then once you do have the shipping container wherever you're going to do this transfer, you have the A-frame set up, they hoist this transfer cask on top of it, and then they have a system of pulleys basically that lifts the sources out of the shipping container into the transfer cask. This was the part that we anticipated carried the most risk. We were doing it in a public area. If something went wrong, it would have been hugely problematic for the hospital. And because they had never actually had sources in this transfer cask itself, they had done a mock source loading a year before. This is where we saw that, you know, they've never used it. This is where we saw the biggest risk as being a potential anyway, for the biggest risk. If that goes well and they get the sources into the transfer cask, then they bring it into the bunker. This gets pushed up on rails against the bottom of the machine, and then the source loading process takes place. So I'm not going to go through all of this, but I want to highlight a couple sort of how we looked at this failure modes analysis and you know, how we used it anyway. So this, you know, where we saw the biggest risk is the transfer from the shipping container into the transfer cask. And that's partly because it hadn't been done before by the company. It was only their third time doing a source loading and first time with this container. So two of these things, the sources don't lift up, not a big deal. Then you just close up the shipping container, send it back, and, you know, at least there's no major consequence. Or it lifts up and gets stuck. And that was, I guess, our biggest nightmare, because there is a small gap between the two containers. They are bolted together. They did try to design it so there wouldn't be a lot of radiation flashing through that gap, but they had never measured it. They hadn't even measured it for the ones that they did in the US. So we had no estimate of what that dose rate might be. Well, we did. I mean, we came up with our own estimate, but We had no measurement of what that dose might be. And you're in a public area, and if this thing gets stuck, what do you do with it if you can't get it down? So that was our biggest nightmare. And then these two are sort of, if you do get the sources into this transfer container, it was manufactured specifically for Ottawa and our Canadian regulatory requirements. It's never had sources in it. So what if there's a manufacturing problem? You know, what if the dose rates are huge? What if there's leakage detected? So those were sort of our scenarios that we considered. And then in this FMEA analysis, you sort of assign how likely is it. That's a guess. Well, we really don't know. We didn't anticipate any leakage from the sources. Nordion has a long track record of making sources, but otherwise it's a guess. How bad would it be if it happens, and how likely are we to notice? Well, we were likely to notice. We were going to notice it, but these were our three riskiest sort of areas. And we did make changes to our source loading plan based on this. The other part of it is, you know, once we have it in the room and we're trying to load the sources into the gamma pod, what might go wrong there? So, you know, maybe they can't align the transfer unit to the treatment unit. Maybe they can't get the sources into the treatment unit. Maybe they don't find all the sources. I'll just sort of point out these first two, and I'll let you know why afterwards, but, you know, not as severe in the sense that we're in a bunker that is shielded with a locked door and all the security in place that's required. So if something went wrong at this point, at least everything is contained. So we figured if we got everything into the bunker, we would breathe a sigh of relief and worst case scenario, close the door and walk away and figure out what to do afterwards. So how did we use it? The biggest change that we made was changing our source loading plan as to where we were going to do this transfer. We had to get approval from the CNSC security division because we'd already submitted a plan. We had to update the rigging plan, but we picked a location that we figured was easier to contain from a security perspective and from a radiation safety perspective if something went wrong. Most of our sort of what do you do if this happens were ended with send the sources back. You need to be authorized to ship sources. So you need this transport of dangerous goods training. I was the only person who had it, and I was actually scheduled for a work thing. I was actually scheduled to be out of the country that weekend that we were doing it. So we made sure we had the proper training for other staff members in case we had to send the sources back so that we could do so. As it turned out, I was there, but originally I wasn't supposed to be there. So how well did we do? How well were my nightmare scenarios? These were the two things essentially that went wrong. I shouldn't say the two things. These were two of the things that went wrong. The not aligning was a problem. It caused about a 1-day delay. We fixed that. We kind of did, but it caused a 1-day delay. It was resolved so they could proceed with the source loading. In the end, they couldn't get the sources out of the source holder into the machine. So they had to be sent back into the shipping container. The shipping container had been gone back the same day to Nordion. We were not authorized to ship this amount of activity. And you have to notify the CNSC at least 2 weeks before or 1 week before or something. The CNSC was present for it. They recognized that it didn't make sense to make us hold on to these things in the hospital while we got licensed to do it. So they and Nordion were fantastic about making some concessions for us to ship them out under Nordion's license so that we could get them off the property. So that basically kicked off the seven most interesting days of my professional life for sure, and seven longest days of my professional life, but we did send the sources back. That was in the fall of 2019. Then there was a root cause analysis that had to be done by the company. I was allowed to go to Nordion and see their investigation and see the sources, which was super interesting. And then they had to answer to the CNSC some things. There were meetings early last winter, and then everything stopped in March. So that's where that all stands. But anyway, that was definitely completely unpredictable and fascinating experience, which I never want to relive. But it really was quite interesting from that perspective. As far as being the radiation safety officer, I will admit now that I totally love it. It's definitely not for everyone. there is a lot of, yeah, there is a lot of sort of playing the game, I guess, a little bit to make sure, you know, you meet all the requirements that within the hospital, different committees are satisfied. Dave always told me that as long as no one knows what the RSO is doing, then you're doing a good job. If they know what you're doing, then you've screwed up somewhere. So, you know, it is way more work than I was led to believe. But it has also been way more interesting. I do enjoy working. You work a lot with people. You talk a lot directly with people. So I do like that part of it. The radiation safety community provincially and nationally is actually, it's small enough that it's a very good community to be a part of. And mostly from a management perspective, you're sort of left alone because no one really wants to know what you're doing and they don't want to ask in case they get involved. So mostly you're left alone to do your own stuff. So that's where I stand now as far as the radiation safety officer goes. But I sort of, Maria alluded to it, that I end up getting involved in a whole bunch of other stuff somehow. So in 2018, I decided to do a certification in diagnostic imaging as well through the CCPM. I tried to come up with a really good reason why I did this for this talk, but I don't have one. There were certainly some, I do have some, but there were certainly some challenges. So I was only a year into being the RSO. It was a very busy time. I don't know anyone personally who has the certification. There aren't that many people relative to radiation oncology physics. So when you're preparing for the CCPM exams, there's this whole question bank, you know, of published questions that you kind of prepare solutions to ahead of time. And then that's part of the exam. I didn't have anyone to go to ask. I don't work in diagnostic imaging. So some of the very clinical questions were way outside of my realm of knowledge. So that was a lot of work preparing for that. I was doing it kind of on my spare time because I was trying to learn to be RSO and I was trying to keep my clinical job going. I was also that term teaching for the first time a university course, which I kind of inherited as the RSO as well. I was doing on my spare time. So it was a pretty psychotic winter when I took that, and I decided to do the fellowship the same year just to throw something else in. So that's the challenges, I guess. So why did I do it? I blame one of my colleagues mainly, but I was already kind of our department's imaging person. I was the person who didn't deny knowledge of imaging, I guess. So when it came to CT commissioning, when it came to questions about imaging, I tended to be the go-to person for that. I had already done some work with the hospital diagnostic imaging department. But more to the point, I guess, is that radiation therapy really can't be separated entirely from imaging at this point anymore. We had just installed an MR simulator. So one of my colleagues had done a second certification and she did an MR in 2017. So she was the one that planted the idea in my head that you should do the X-ray, the diagnostic certification as well. So that's why I say I blame her for that. Within our department, I think it positions us very well clinically to have certifications in both of those realms, as well as everyone having the radiation therapy certification. Also for our residency program, we would like to start an imaging residency program. There aren't a lot of them around. We are asked all the time about that. So it would be very nice to start that. That is our intention at some point, hopefully sooner rather than later. And having those two certifications in the department helps with that as far as getting CAMPEP accreditation for that. What it has done for me, recertification will require some creativity for the physicists who are certified to go through the recertification. The CCPM has some rules around having multiple certifications. You can't have more than two. They don't count mammography in that, but you can't have more than two. They expect that you spend at least 25% of your time in your secondary certification, which is fine. I definitely do spend 25% of my time on imaging stuff, but they require 100% of the credits when you recertify. So you have to have 100% of the credits in both your specialties, but you only need 25% of the time in one of them. It won't be a problem, but it'll take some creativity. I have been involved in a bunch of projects with diagnostic imaging, and I have done some contract work with the Children's Hospital here. I did that, and I'm pointing that out here, I did that as a representative of our physics department. I did not do that as my own contract work. I was asked to do it personally. but that is not why I did the certification. I did it primarily because I think it benefits our department a lot. So I thought this was also a good benefit for our department because it gives us some connections, some communication with other experts in the field. But it kind of begs the question, I mentioned that the CCPM has their own rules. Can you really be an expert in more than one discipline? It's not easy. So the CCPM has their opinion on that. Yes, you can. And yes, I feel that I can, but obviously I have a better breadth of knowledge in radiation oncology than I do in imaging. So the work I did for CHEO was a little bit intimidating. They needed a diagnostic certified physicist to sign off on acceptance testing of this new machine. I had to Google what the machine was when they asked me about it. It is a very unique pediatric thing that I had never in my life heard of. Anyone I asked had never heard of it. I eventually contacted someone at Sick Kids Hospital in Toronto who sent me their acceptance test documents. So yes, I didn't feel particularly expert. I'd only just done my certification and never heard of this thing. So I didn't feel overly expert, but an x-ray tube is an x-ray tube at the end of the day. So that part of it was fine. I am still working to kind of increase my foothold a little bit in diagnostic imaging, not in the department per se, just in that realm. Even within our own CT simulators and stuff, I'm trying to get more involved there, but that will take a bit of time, I think. But what I want to get to, I guess, is teaching. So I mentioned that, you know, one of our hopes is to develop an imaging residency within the department. So I have been quite involved in the residency program here for a number of years. We also do a lot of teaching with radiology residents, radiation oncology residents. I've done a bunch of high school outreach programs. My husband's a high school teacher, so I get in with a bunch of science teachers. He's not a science teacher, but he puts me in touch with a bunch of science teachers there. I really do enjoy the teaching part of it. Our physics residency program is where most of my teaching efforts have been concentrated. And I've been a member of that committee since about, I don't even remember, but 2015, 2016-ish. So how did I end up being program director? Like the RSO position is not something that I intended or asked for. I think I was the default, and I may have been the default for the RSO position too, but I've never had the guts to ask on that one. But this is another hugely administrative role, so there's a lot of paperwork required by CAMPEP. But the previous program director had done it for a number of years and basically wanted a break because it is a big administrative role. It is a lot of work. So she basically wanted a break. The program was an excellent position. It was well, you know, set up. Everything was well in order. She wanted to step down, not right before a CAMPEP reaccreditation. So she thought this right between the 5-year reaccreditation times was a good time for her to step down. And realistically, it's not even meant to be a joke that it was sort of by default. I think it was by default. I really was the only person who'd had enough involvement in the committee up to now to be able to step into that relatively seamlessly. Joel Mullins, who's on the call, could tell you it probably hasn't been entirely seamless. He and I are learning the ropes together on this one because I took over on September 1st on the same day he started. So he has got to experience my learning curve as well. But by and large, the program was well set up. So, I can't screw it up that badly right away, I don't think. I like it in the sense that I'm involved in that a lot, and I have a lot of stake in our residency program. It is something that I put a ton of value in. So I do, I'm happy to be the program director, although I would have been happy for someone else to keep doing it as well. But it is, the program itself is something I have a lot of stake in, so I do want to see it successful. I guess this rambling talk that I've managed to fit into the 45 minutes is more to say that, you know, a clinical career path, you kind of have this idea that, okay, you do your certification and then you choose your specialization, whether it's radiation oncology or imaging or MR, nuclear medicine, and then that's where you work. I think the idea of specialization really doesn't apply in the same way that it used to. Certainly in radiation therapy, you can no longer separate out. You can't say that imaging and radiation therapy are completely separated. It's even from the perspective of not even talking image guidance, but even from the perspective of the diagnostic imaging that is used to do the contouring, to do the, you know, the planning, to do the all of that, you can't get away from understanding and working with diagnostic imaging from PET scans to MR to X-ray images. So I think the idea of specialization where you do your certification and then you stay in that realm forever is no longer really applies. It doesn't mean everyone has to go out and do a second certification, but it means everyone is at least somewhat aware of or works in more than one realm. On the other hand, I think specialization now probably means different things, in that I would be hard pressed to go and do much with our CyberKnife machine because I've never been on that team. That is a fairly specialized team. I would struggle to turn the thing on and run it. So there is specialization, certainly. And me being certified in diagnostic imaging doesn't mean I could go do anything in cardiac imaging. It's not where I, you know, it's not where my knowledge lies. So there is certainly specialization, and I don't mean to imply that it's not. Especially in a big department, you definitely do get areas of specialization where some people, you can't do everything. So people get specialized in different things, but I think the conventional kind of idea of imaging or therapy or MR doesn't necessarily need to apply anymore. So certainly for the grad students, regardless of what, we've had a ton of residents come out of imaging backgrounds who are now radiation therapy physicists, but they've come from an imaging background. And I think that actually strengthens the department that way. And I guess the other conclusion I would make from this whole thing is that I don't ever say no. So if you want me to do anything, you can ask me and I'll usually agree to it. So that's my sort of general overview and rambling talk for a Friday afternoon. So thank you.